Hi, I'm Steve Sandler, the Managing Director and CTO at PicoTest. Today's video is focused on the selection of the voltage regulator module, or VRM. Whether you're designing, purchasing, or managing the selection of a VRM, this video will provide you with the essential information you need to make a smart choice. There are literally thousands of PWM controllers and commercial VRMs to choose from. Selecting the wrong one can result in additional printed circuit board spins, excessive troubleshooting costs, and in some cases even a complete redesign might be necessary. Making this process even more difficult, much of what you need to know about the VRM isn't published in the datasheets. There are many figures of merit for VRMs. In this video, I'll focus primarily on output impedance with a little bit of discussion about power supply rejection ratio, or PSOR, since these really highlight the selection and optimization choices. The two key points highlighted in this video are why flat impedance is the PDN design goal and that the selection of the VRM isn't arbitrary. We'll use a powerful combination of measurements and simulations to compare common options. We'll compare voltage mode and current mode control schemes, as well as shunt and series feedback compensation with transconductance feedback amplifiers. At the end of the video, you'll be able to download my simulator workspace so that you can use my models yourself. I'll also provide some links and additional information that you might find helpful. Unfortunately, many semiconductor companies offer VRM reference designs and low-cost evaluation boards that aren't close to our flat impedance goal. These boards are generally designed using 402 size chip components to minimize size, and they don't include high fidelity measurement connections. This means that we can't easily characterize the design, and we can't easily optimize it by changing components. And since the impedance isn't flat, this VRM can't be represented using a resistor-inductor model in a signal integrity simulator. We replicated the same evaluation board design on our low-cost prototype printed circuit board using larger 805 size chip components and including high-fidelity connections for measuring PSOR, impedance, and Bode plots. We made provisions for polymer electrolytic input and output capacitors as an alternative to the original ceramics. We also added a USB port for 5-volt power so that we can demonstrate our VRM in our classes and workshops without a benchtop power supply. A low-cost printed circuit board like this makes the testing process much faster, and we use the measurements to develop our simulation models. The models are then used to optimize the design, while the larger chip components we used can easily be changed during the optimization process. Our improved design of this VRM is flat and can be represented as 9 milliohms and 4 nanohenries in a signal integrity simulator. These two simulations are an unfair comparison, but I wanted to show the previous reference design connected to a small printed circuit board plane and unmatched ceramic decoupling, and compare it to our improved flat impedance design using the same printed circuit board plane and matched decoupling up to 10 MHz. In both simulations, an ideal 10 nanofarad ceramic capacitor is placed at the load, which is where we're measuring. You can see that the reference design results in a number of impedance peaks, and the improved design has just one peak. Even though the ideal 10 nanofarad capacitor at the load is not properly matched in either case, the peak in the reference design is almost an order of magnitude larger than in our improved design. These impedance peaks pose a problem. One impedance peak results in a voltage transient when subjected to a dynamic load current. When more than one peak is present, it's possible to create a current transient in such a way as to stack the individual voltage transients on top of each other. This stack voltage, referred to as a rogue wave, is much larger than that could be produced from the individual resonant peaks. The rogue wave can cause circuits to malfunction, and in some cases can even result in permanent damage. If you're interested, you can find more about rogue waves in a previous Keysight how-to video titled How to Design for Power Integrity, Finding Power Delivery Noise Problems. Datasheets don't tell us everything we need to know. Much better fidelity is achieved by using measurement-based component models, particularly for output capacitors and inductors. I mount the individual components I'm considering on a low-cost printed circuit board to obtain high-fidelity measurements. Then I save the measurements in touchstone format and use them in my simulations. This way I can optimize the use of components and choose the ones that are best for my application. These components and the VRMs are measured using a two-port shunt-through measurement technique. The two-port shunt through measurement is a high-fidelity technique for measuring milliohm impedances over a wide frequency range. Instrument setup files and instructions can be found in the download links. By carefully matching the VRM, circuit board planes, and decoupling capacitors, the impedance profile can be tuned to be very flat up to high frequencies. In order to accomplish this impedance flatness, all capacitors need to provide a well-controlled, precise series resistance. This control is obtained by using either ESR-controlled capacitors or low ESR capacitors with external series resistors. The most common VRM topology is the non-isolated step-down synchronous DC to DC converter, sometimes referred to as a synchronous buck. The circuit can be approximated as a two-state machine. In state 1, the upper MOSFET switch 1 is turned on and the lower MOSFET is turned off. In this state, the input voltage is connected to the output filter inductor and current flows in a large loop through the input capacitor, output inductor, output capacitor, and back to the input capacitor. In state 2, the output filter inductor is grounded through the lower MOSFET switch 2. And at frequencies well below the switching frequency, the output is represented by the average of the two states using a state space average model. The output voltage is controlled by the duty cycle, representing percentage of the time that switch 1 is on. With voltage mode control, the duty cycle is set by comparing the error amplifier output VC with a fixed sawtooth ramp. The open loop output impedance is represented as a low impedance voltage source in series with the output inductor. The current mode control scheme incorporates the same two switching states, but with current mode control, the output is set by comparing the error amplifier output VC with a current signal related to the output current. A small voltage ramp is added to the current signal in order to stabilize the current loop, which can be unstable at half the switching frequency. The open loop output impedance is represented by a much higher impedance current source. By adding appropriate feedback amplifier compensation, either voltage mode or current mode control can generally achieve a flat impedance. Large open loop tolerances associated with the RDS on of the MOSFET and the DCR of the output inductor result in a widely varying low frequency resistance using voltage mode control. The current mode control scheme avoids these large tolerances. Current mode control can also achieve much better PSR performance than voltage mode, as illustrated in the 20 dB improvement seen here. Many state-of-the-art VRM controllers use transconductance feedback amplifiers in place of voltage feedback amplifiers. A shunt termination scheme is often recommended and implemented in the manufacturer's reference design. Another option is a series termination scheme. Series and shunt feedback schemes can often be adjusted to yield the same nominal gain, as shown here. The feedback amplifier transconductance GM typically has a large and often unspecified tolerance. The shunt scheme is much more sensitive to this tolerance, evidenced by the much larger gain variance seen here. As a result, series feedback is usually preferable to shunt feedback, despite the manufacturer's recommendation. The shunt feedback transconductance amplifier is particularly unsuitable for use in voltage mode control. The output filter inductor results in a pole in the control loop. This pole is typically canceled by a zero in the feedback amplifier, resulting in a flat impedance profile. The shunt feedback scheme is ineffective for this, since a pole is created by the bottom feedback divider resistor at a frequency that's very close to the zero. The undesirable pole results in an impedance peak that can only be canceled by adding a very large bulk output capacitor, which is impractical for both size and cost reasons. After carefully tuning voltage mode and current mode VRMs to achieve similar flat impedance profiles, realistic tolerances are added to the simulation. Despite similar nominal impedance profiles, current mode control with series terminated feedback is much less sensitive to component tolerances. It wasn't possible to create a flat impedance using voltage mode control and shunt feedback, so we didn't simulate the shunt feedback for current mode either. We created a state-based VRM model to perform AC simulations of the output impedance and PSR in this video. The state-space model implemented can also support much more advanced simulations, such as Bode plots and input impedance. A harmonic balance simulation allows us to see voltage and current harmonics, as well as time domain representations of VRM signals, such as output ripple, the switch voltage, and the inductor current. A transient simulator can also be included to simulate the VRM voltage response to a load current perturbation. And all of these simulations can include the circuit board planes. In this video, I used measurement-based simulation to show that current mode topology is the best choice for a flat impedance VRM, and also that series feedback is generally preferable to shunt feedback for the transconductance feedback amplifier. I've also shown that nominal measurements don't tell the whole story. Simulation can be used to show the sensitivities of the design topology, as well as individual component sensitivities. If you'd like to explore these power integrity examples, you can download the ADS workspace I used by clicking on the link in the text description associated with this video, or by typing in the URL shown on this slide.